Thank you, Dowell, and thank you for this opportunity to present to you today on the California High-Speed Rail project. I've been working on this project for several years, and often the question I get when I meet somebody new is that project really happening? So on the flyer that we sent out in preparation for this course was high-speed rail, it's happening, right? Just a couple of slides, I'll overview the project. Let me get set up here. California High-Speed Rail, phase one, we're going to build the project in two phases. Phase one will stretch from Anaheim up to San Francisco. It's 520 miles long, and we plan to open that up in 2029. The extensions down to San Diego and up to Sacramento are phase two, and we don't have an implementation year for that. We need to get the phase one going, but we are doing planning in those areas for those projects right now. Just a brief history on California High-Speed Rail. Governor Jerry Brown started talking about the project in the 70s, and through the 80s some analysis was done, and in 1996 the California High-Speed Rail Authority was created. And then in 2008 California voters approved Proposition 1A, which for the first time gave funding for a high-speed rail project in the U.S. And so after that, a series of actions by the Obama administration and then more actions by the state legislature have created our ability to actually get the project up and on the ground. And so so we have major construction underway in Central Valley today, and we're gonna see a brief video on the work that we're doing there in a few slides down. So what are we trying to do with the project? It's got, if you boil down all the benefits that'll come out of the project, you can pretty much capture them in this slide here, which talks about increased mobility. It's a needed alternative. The project will have better air quality because of the project, and there will be job growth as a result of construction and operations and the economic development created by the project. So some of the problems that were addressed in our ability to decide that high-speed rail was a good alternative to choose is that California is, in the Los Angeles to San Francisco market, it's the busiest short-haul air trip market in the U.S. One of five flights out of San Francisco area comes to Los Angeles area, and six of our top 30 congested urban corridors are in the U.S., or in California. Interesting one here is the population growth. It's estimated to reach 50 million by 2050, and whether that's 2050 or you know, maybe a few years later, but around 2050, we have about 40 million people in California today, and so that's about 10 million people that are projected to be here by 2050. So to put that into context, you could take the entire state of Washington and the entire state of Oregon, and that's just over 10 million people, and move them here, and that's what we have to accommodate. Or another way to think about it is that's about the population of LA County. So just to put that in perspective about how many people are projected to come here. We have the project is intended to help us meet our air quality standards and our greenhouse gas objectives that were passed in AB 32 and SB 375. As you know, it's no surprise to anybody here that we have some of the worst air communities in the country. And the alternatives that we were looked at to help us address these problems were costly. And here's a slide on some of the analysis that was done. The equivalent new capacity between San Francisco and Los Angeles would cost $158 billion. Would require 4,300 new highway lane miles, 115 additional airport gates, and four new airports and runways. The even just, you know, even if we were to expand the air or any of those modes, can you imagine the opposition that we would try to get if we were to try to expand LAX into the surrounding neighborhoods? Or I actually live in Long Beach underneath the flight path, and every time JetBlue or another airline wants to even add one more trip, the signs come up, and everybody's in opposition. So every project, of course, comes with its challenges And certainly, we're very constricted about the kinds of solutions we have available to us. High-speed rail was found to be efficient, take less right-of-way, and be sustainable, and help to address the problems I talked about on the earlier slides. The travel time that we're mandated to get between downtown Los Angeles and downtown San Francisco is 2 hours and 40 minutes. And so comparative air time is about an hour between San Francisco Airport and LAX. But when you look at the total trip travel time, we are extremely competitive, or will be extremely competitive, with the airlines for that market. It's about total trip time. We're just about the same door-to-door as you'd be looking at when you consider your Uber ride, and then your wait, and then your TSA, and then the getting on the plane and the taxi and all that. So when you get to LA Union Station, you'll walk onto a train and you'll be right at San Francisco Transbay Terminal. Door-to-door travel time, we're very competitive. So that's the market that high-speed rail is most competitive in, although we do anticipate that we will be collecting trips along the way as well. And then down here I have the car. It's, you're talking 8 hours, six, 8 hours in the car, depending on traffic. And so we're we're competing with the air, not the car. Some of the goals of this program, and we have an entire sustainability program that permeates through everything that we do, as far as using 100% renewable energy, and our trains will be entirely powered by electricity. This is just a couple of examples on what our sustainability programs, how we address it. So to construct the project, we're mandate that our contractors have very, very clean trucks, as clean as they can get. But there will still be some emissions from those trucks, and then so to accommodate, to mitigate those types of emissions, we have a very, very, very aggressive tree planting program that we'll be doing throughout the state. So that's one way we can offset that during construction. And then to get power, I've talked about the renewable energy. It will take some emissions to actually create that energy so that the trains can be powered. But it's offset by the riders that will be on the train. And rather than taking the other modes, will be an extremely greenhouse gas friendly mode of transportation. So the interesting part on how we help shape cities, and thinking about the urban aspect of this, we're tying communities together like never before. So the travel time between San Jose and Fresno, or like Bakersfield to Los Angeles, is 3 hours today by car, 3 to 4 hours depending on traffic. High-speed rail will go three times faster than that. Will be downtown Bakersfield to downtown Los Angeles in an hour. That's as long as it would take for me to get from here to downtown Long Beach on the Blue Line today. So Bakersfield will be in that kind of market once our system is up and going. And so you can think about the kind of businesses or industry or relationship to housing that could have if an operation company like Google now wants to locate maybe in Bakersfield and be an hour away from Los Angeles, or people that live in Bakersfield want to get to jobs in LA. We create this whole new dynamic because of high-speed rail. So we will connect and reinforce with our local systems. Great thing about high-speed rail is, unlike the airlines, which is our competitive market that we're looking at, we're not really creating TOD villages around LAX, but we can around high-speed rail. We can plan for access, housing, transit-oriented development, the pedestrian and bicycle access, driverless cars, all the great things that we're trying to do with TOD. We can plan for that kind of access around high-speed rail. So you get airport type of generation markets that have these long distance trips, the visitors and business travelers and hotels that would now pop up around our TOD areas. But you have markets that can actually be attracted at the length of the airline travel. So we have a new tool to revitalize our downtown with high-speed rail. to help us get to the best possible planning we can get around our station. The authority committed to doing station area planning with the communities. So we've got eight station area planning contracts up and going, and part of that, what we're doing with each community, these station area planning contracts are led by the cities, and they each involve visioning and community engagement and financial analysis and looking for private investment, and a very key part of this is how do we actually get it implemented. And Catherine Perez Estolano was in this room, I believe, 2 years ago. She was a former board member of ours, and she was talking about a very interesting concept of doing district planning, and eco-districts was the tool that she named. And so eco-districts is a mechanism that we've actually employed the eco-district. There's actually a firm in Portland that helps to organize how you think and plan about communities. And it's not just transportation, but planning for energy, water, waste, transportation, and think about all as a package. Our stations will be sustainable and LEED certified, and the best that we can make what's in our own control. But working within a district and thinking about how other elements can be in relation to it, and we can think about it all as a system, is what the eco districts is a format that helps us to get to there. So we're just starting that process as an element as we're working with these communities in their station area planning. We're also we're looking at how, in the end result, when we look at implementation, is there a district approach that we can take that gets us 1 + 1 more than just 1 + 1 = 2, 1 + 1 = 3, 4, or 5. So in the station area planning, we're serving our local communities. We want to maximize our multimodal access.
Gosh.
We want to reduce land needed for new growth, and we want to increase high-speed rail ridership and revenue. That's our outcomes that we're looking to get. Each one will be a multimodal transportation hub. We'll implement transit-oriented development policies. We'll promote economic development and coordinate with local governments. So what's going on right now? We've got a whole bunch of stuff that was advanced in our 2016 business plan that we have to update every couple of years, that taking the actual financial analysis in our available funds, we selected the corridors that we would build in the near term and looked at a financial strategy that could get those projects and revenue going from the operations and the tickets on that, so that we could actually be in a financial position to better build the rest of the line. So the green portion is the targeted portion that we're going to build first, and look to that, get that portion operating by 2015, and that, or sorry, 2025, and that's from a this is so fast, we're going back in time. And that would be from approximately Bakersfield to San Jose, and then if additional funds are found, the next place that we would build would be up to San Francisco. And meanwhile, we'd be in the Burbank to Anaheim section, we'd be looking to build priority projects that would help Metrolink go faster and safer and get more get better transit service in this area in anticipation for high-speed rail. So the 2016 business plan laid out a strategy to get there. And these were the three main objectives. So initiate high-speed rail service as soon as possible, make strategic concurrent investments, and be ready when funding becomes available. So the portions of between San Jose and San Francisco and between Bakersfield and Anaheim, We're going full steam ahead, getting those environmental work cleared, so that when funding becomes available, all of that environmental clearance will be ready, and we'll be able to construct. So, right now in the Central Valley, today, there's about 119 miles under construction from Madera to north of Bakersfield, and that's approximately $3 billion of investment going on. And now I want to play this for you. This was presented to our board recently.
Since the start of construction more than a year ago, the project now has 7 active sites, with more to come in the fall. The Fresno River Viaduct continues to take shape, now much of it a freestanding structure. Our newest project site is also one of the fastest moving. This is the Cottonwood Creek Viaduct. Work is underway on both sides of the Union Pacific tracks that cross the San Joaquin River. The San Joaquin Viaduct will include a pergola and arches forming the northern gateway of the high-speed rail entering Fresno. Progress is easy to see at the 99 realignment. Granite Construction has been awarded the contract for the next phase. Foundation work has been completed for a few sections of the Fresno Trench. This animation has been shared with the public and local media to help them understand the traffic impacts this project will create. After more than 166,000-pound girders were placed on the Tuolumne Bridge in June, crews are working to complete this portion of the bridge by October. Work will then start on either end of the bridge to connect it to the city streets. 9 rebar cages reach into the sky at the Cedar Viaduct in South Fresno. Concrete is being poured to complete those columns. Drilling is now moving north across North Avenue, where more columns will be constructed.
So that's construction, and I'm going to talk a little bit about what we're doing in the environmental work that's necessary in the southern and northern portions. So in Southern California, we and this is our Bakersfield to Los Angeles, and then also Los Angeles to San Diego. Los Angeles to San Diego is doing some preliminary upfront work, but the environmental work is all being done in Bakersfield to Los Angeles. And some of the work that I mentioned, early projects that can happen, I'm going to focus on these four areas below here. So some of the work that we can advance in anticipation of high-speed rail coming to this area, we're building pass-through tracks. We're helping to fund that at Union Station. Currently, Amtrak trains that come in have to come into a cul-de-sac before they can back out, and so this will allow through movement through there. And then we're also solving some of the grade crossing challenges we have at some of the most congested intersections for rail today in our area. And we've also helped to Metrolink to buy new locomotives and put positive train control, which is a safety element that helps the trains to not run into each other in case of operator error. So those are some of the projects that we've been able to advance right now. And I'll give you one. This is second video.
The intersection of Rosecrans and Marquardt Avenues in Santa Fe Springs has been identified as the highest priority railroad grade crossing in California. Up to 109 trains and 52,000 vehicles pass through this intersection each day, not to mention anyone trying to cross the street. Safety is a top concern.
In order for the person to get from here to there, you have to go cross Marquardt and then cross the railroad tracks and then cross Rosecrans and then cross Marquardt again to get over there. It's been 25 accidents, 4 fatalities and 6 injuries in about 10 to 15 years. And as you can see, the train's coming right now.
Each week, the crossing arms are down for a combined 21 hours. Add that up over the course of a year, and you're talking about 45 days. Think of all the cars idling, releasing greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. A $137 million grade separation project would build a vehicle bridge over the tracks. This will be done using private, local, state, and federal funding, as well as $68 million from the California High-Speed Rail Authority. The Rosecrans-Marquardt project provides benefits to the corridor and region by significantly increasing safety, eliminating delays, and improving the environment.
So the most important part is that we do not have to cross any railroads, either by bicycle or pedestrian or vehicular. So that's the good thing.
To help us plan for the rest of the areas in South and North, we have to balance everything that we do to as we plan. We have project objectives. We got to meet that 2 hours and 40 minutes required travel time between Los Angeles and San Francisco. So that dictates, you know, how sharp our curves can be and elements like that. We have environmental laws that have been passed, and we have to follow those and make sure that we're balancing. We're not doing environmental harm to the extent possible. And then we work with the community, and the community is just a lot of work, one on one or one on many, with the community, and each one of these elements we're balancing as we move forward. And to give you an idea just how much all this influences how we think, this is just one example that we're looking at here between Palmdale and Burbank. When we started looking at that alignment in 2010, we were mostly following the SR 114 as it travels between those areas. And that's also about where Metrolink goes. Metrolink has a lot more sharper curves than we do, so we couldn't go on their tracks. But we looked at that, and then through evolution, every year, doing lots of analysis, lots of community engagement, we've evolved to the point in 2016 where one of these three alignments, or some variation of that's closely related to those, will be our preferred alignment that we plan to select at the end of 2017. I'll cut these short. I'll just focus on one of these slides, but this gives you an idea of all the work. And as we're presenting, we were out in Acton on Saturday and talking to the community and gave a presentation on where we're at. But through each of our alternatives, after all that work, we're able to define what we found through our refinement goals, like address our vertical profile to improve operations. That's the project objective. And then avoid impacts to the Big Tahunga Wash or mitigation area, so that would be more the environmental. And then in refine alignments to reduce impacts to residential areas, elements that we learned through the community engagement. So how that's balancing those objectives. And then the results, as we've been able to come up with this alternative, I'm not saying this is the preferred, this is just one of, the several that we're looking at, but how these have been addressed are laid out in the results, and then that's what how we're able to communicate the work that we've done and how we've been able to evolve our alignments as we learn more. So each one of these alignments will go get the entire environmental analysis that's required. And all that analysis then will go into our recommendations to our board, which will then be in our environmental document and our record of decision we hope to have at the end of 2017. At that point, the project will be that preparedness for implementation. So, there they are right there. So that's a schedule for our environmental work. This just happens to be Burbank, Palmdale to Burbank, but each of the sections going through environmental work right now, including the San Francisco to Merced segments, are going through this very similar timeline. And I think we made it at 30 minutes, just in time for some more discussion here. Lots of tunnels, yes. The longest one we're looking at is 22 miles. The red that you see there is tunnel. the or underground could be cut and cover. The blue is elevated bridge, and the green is surface. And surface might include just being on top of a berm, but we're on the ground. This is a very, very challenging section. Yes, we have some of the best tunnel experts in the world helping us examine this.
They're doing geological studies down hundreds, if not thousands, of feet.
Yes, we've been doing core samples, and the hikers have been up there and doing core samples. We were at risk at one point of losing some equipment because of the fires this summer, but we're definitely out in the remote areas and doing more survey work than's ever been done in this corridor.
So let me begin as a quote, the discussant. In full disclosure, I am a member of this team. I probably shouldn't be throwing any tomatoes or shoes at this project because I'm a part of this project, et cetera. But I wanted to ask Tony and sort of phrase this part as a series of questions that I think all of us on the team are asking. let me also, in full disclosure, indicate that in my career, high-speed train is not just the system that's going to be implemented, but it's also in the planning process that we're involved with as well. Tony indicated that we have something called the record determination, which is the completion of the environmental process, December of next year. And our team just started on this about a little over a year ago in July, so it's been an incredibly expedited effort to move forward. Well, let me start. We haven't done this in the United States before. You know, editorial aside, we used to sort of be at the forefront of technology in the world. We landed humans on the moon before anyone else landed humans on the moon, but we didn't quite think in the United States about getting people around on the ground, nearly with the effectiveness of the technology that we sent folks to the moon. And so it's probably been, I think, from my understanding, close to 50 years that we've had high-speed trains in Japan. And we've had them, I don't need to go through the litany of the various countries throughout the world. So we're starting this from scratch, in effect, in the United States, except we're not starting from scratch. What have we learned, Tony, from what has been developed in other nations and effectively used and implemented in other nations that are enabling us to proceed with not just starting on a white slate, but moving forward? What are the key lessons and thoughts that we've learned through those processes that are helping inform what we're doing here?
Right. A ton of information gathering has been done from the international community, of course. Let me just pull out two that that seem to be, that we can actually talk about it at any length here today. So the first is probably about actually the structure of how the program will be funded. We are initiating environmental clearance, and with government dollars, state and federal dollars, we're going to construct a significant portion of that. We learned this from Japan. In doing the implementation of that, you're able to attract private investment that can help you build the rest of it. So it's very much designed after the Japanese model of a public-private partnership to construct the project. The state would remain in ownership and then sell it to a concessionaire, who would then take responsibility for operating, and then through that investment, through the projected revenues of that, also be able to fund even portions of the project. So that's how most of Japan was built. The recent extension that they are planning to build is there's so much knowledge now in Japan about the value return on the corridor in investing in high-speed rail that they're not doing the prep work like they've done on the other corridor, the government is. They're putting it out to bid right from the start. So that's one. And then the vehicle technology is another one, just taking straight off the books on what's been done in the other countries, and then taking a mix of all that and putting that into what will go out onto the street as our bid for vehicles. And so that's been vetted clearly up and down with the known state of the practice throughout the world in what our vehicles will look like. And that's important because that dictates all of our, how do you design the system? So what's our, what does our power look like? And then what is our, what are our platform lengths and how high do they have to be? And the elements of all those ripple effects on selecting your vehicle are all governed by what we learn from the international community. On and on and on, but yes, very much okay. The standards brought to
an
us.
An important point about the fact that we do have a learning process and that we haven't done in the United States, but we have a basis to learn from in terms of practice. Let me ask a sort of second question. There, you had a schedule up here and you had some cost information up here. Big price tag that we often see in the press, issues about the price tag, et cetera, and people challenging the numbers, et cetera. And also the fact that the time frame, when you look at the length from San Francisco to, let's say, Los Angeles total, and ultimately down to San Diego, it's a long system, it's a big system. What do you see as the key obstacles, and how are we thinking, how does the authority look at overcoming some of those key obstacles to make it work, and make that time frame work, and make it work in an economically feasible way?
The very early action items that need to be settled and planned for so you can make those timelines, right-of-way inability to, which scales back to then in your environmental, you have to define your project so you can know what you're targeting. And right-of-way is, part of our American culture in land ownership. And we definitely have a very, very structured compensation program, and I was thinking even about bringing some of our success stories that we've been doing in Fresno here with some of the community that's been relocated there and businesses, but having that very early knowledge about what property we might be impacting is very important to the community members, and the earlier we can identify that and give more either assurance or recognition that a property will be acquired is going to be better. So early as possible on right of way, and then the other challenge is early on vehicle acquisition. It takes a very long time to order, build, and then test trains on the track. So some of those very early action items we need to know now. elements so that we can be ready to meet those deadlines that seem so far away.
Okay. Let me ask, one of those obstacles can be, as we well know, in any, it's not just transportation projects, but it's land development processes, et cetera, is the public. And we have a public that, again, in the United States, a little in California, has no experience with this kind of system. What are some of the messages? How do we begin? How is the authority looking at addressing the concerns of the public through this process, who feel, in many respects, because they show up in masses, and there have been a lot of TV press in terms of opposition, it's going to change our rural lifestyle, it's going to have all these negative impacts. What are some of the ways to overcome some of those issues that are being challenges thrown up by the public?
Yeah, most of the issues I hear are at the community level. And not at the, it's a not challenging the project in general, although some of the concerns you do hear at the community meetings who are concerned about the project we ask a lot of questions about what the project is intended to do in general, but a lot of it is just like any planning project that we work on is how are we interacting with the community that we move through, and so there's. We just got through with since February. I think we were engaged in about 30 different community meetings up and down the state where we were just out again and we're planning again to go through that whole process. And like I showed on the slides, as we learn working with the community. Because we don't know unless we work with them and learn, we are adjusting, and if we can't adjust, we're we're helping to get information back on what could potential mitigations be. So there's no other way to do that except for actually being out there and working with the community to find out, and it just takes a lot of hours to be out there.
Speaking of the communities, this is a system that in some cases will be constructed and is being constructed now in what I call more rural agricultural kinds of areas, and there are also pieces that will be constructed and are being constructed in what I call urbanized areas. And it's, you know, obviously there will be some kind of disruption, right? If there's land acquisition, there may be existing uses that may need to be removed, be it commercial, industrial, housing uses that need to be removed. Plus the system itself, you know, you have platforms that are approaching a quarter mile in length. It's not a light rail station in any sense of the imagination. It's much bigger, the scale in terms of the infrastructure overlay onto the fabric of our communities is substantial. What are some of the ways that it doesn't become a wall? I you know, was telling Tony earlier, I worked in the Jefferson Los Angeles TOD planning program under a grant for SCAG in the city of Los Angeles, and Metro built it in the worst possible way because they divided the community by building a wall. If any of you are familiar there, when they promised the community they were not going to build a wall, they were going to maintain integrity of the community on north and south side of that station, and Metro deserves to be chastised. And I have commented to some friends there about that as well. But how do we integrate this in a way that it doesn't have that situation that we had on Jefferson Law again? What are the kind of benefits that we can make, and all these things, pieces and fitting together?
That's another huge lesson learned from the international examples of stations that have been in place that maybe have created these barriers, and how some of the cities that we've been examining are now creating, you know, new thoroughfares through the stations that you can either access the station or go through the stations, because that because they've learned, you know, if you only open access to one side, you're cut off another, that you're only getting your economic benefit on one side, and you don't want to turn your back. So so as we've started to plan for stations, we are very much looking at the integration into the community, and it could be, you know, building pedestrian bridge accesses on either end of that quarter mile, which then instead of like our light rail stations where you're planning just a quarter mile, you're actually able to plan 2 quarter mile accesses separated by a quarter mile. So we don't have walk circles, we have walk ovals that we're able to get to. So we have a very, very broad footprint of capture area that we can capture for the different modes of just walking and biking that are more beneficial than we could just draw with a car. So we're trying to create as much permeability as we can and make each station fit into the community. But that quarter mile station, and you know, sometimes it might not be that length, it might be a little shorter, but the total length of that we can work with and are going to be engaging with our every station city to maximize access and so we can be as good a promoter, economic development or whatever they want to do with their city as possible.
Well, plus I think as you commented, the interface with the local planning teams, which is the very and rare in these kind of circumstances of planning as well. My last question to you, Tony, is we live in a political environment. Change the administration in D.C., for better or worse, is going to change, and no editorial comment here. In December, we will be, obviously, Jerry Brown, who's been a very strong proponent of this. His term is coming to an end before some of the time frames that we have here. How do we keep the momentum going in a potentially volatile political environment of changing administrations, et cetera? How do we keep the commitment, if you will, going for to make sure that this is a priority and needs to be carried forward?
So a couple of things on that. An enormous amount of progress will be made by 2019 on the project. And we'll actually be plan to be testing trains at that time. So that'll be, you know, in operation. The other element about political support, the Prop 1A was passed by the voters and not just a decree by the governor, and so there's statewide support from it by the voters. So we'd actually be going not just against, we'd have to overturn what the citizens already approved to stop the project, I think. I'm not actually sure what the legal process is, but it'll have so much, so much momentum, so much construction will already be in place. It'll be very challenging to stop the project, although we're humans, and we change things as a society. That's
thank you. Questions from you folks.
Hi, Tony. My name is Xiangyu Li, and my friend and I are working on a land use and transportation analysis for the Fresno station that you have mentioned. And we so far we have gathered two major concerns. The first is people are worrying about the immediate areas around the station might become a sea of parking. And the second is the station might become a magnet boosting the suburbanization and urban sprawl in the area, especially within 5 miles of the station, and which is already a serious problem in this city and already in the state. So what's your organization's target and strategies to diminish those environmental nuisances?
So the work in Fresno, that Fresno's doing is trying to attract businesses and housing and infill toward their central city. They've had a lot of suburbanization, and so they've got some pretty innovative policies that they've adopted and that their city council has adopted to help make development easier in their infill. And the sea of parking is nobody wants to see that, right? Although if the situation is parking, it could be parking until development is ready to go near the station as well. So it's not always a long-term situation where parking stays as parking. The extent of sprawl out to 5 miles. 5 miles is still within about the city boundaries, right? And so the hope is by working with the city and working within their policies and helping them on address their access needs that they think are important to actually keep downtown thriving. That's what we can help with. We saw some of the bridges and that we're building and some of the viaducts and things. And as we work with the community, we're trying to make all that fit to promote the development closer to the station as much as we can. I don't think we have the analysis done that it would actually produce sprawl outside of the city. The research that we found has been more of a concentrating element toward the city because it functions more like a TOD rather than an airport.
I recently wrote a paper on this topic that looked a lot at the international comparisons you were talking about. And what I seemed to find in the literature was that the success of these systems depends almost entirely on meeting or exceeding demand projections and kind of substituting, meeting or exceeding demand projections and from substitution away from aviation, which you talked about competing primarily with air travel instead of car travel. So I guess my question is kind of two-part. One, what's behind the demand projections? How accurate do you think they are? And two, the primary purpose does seem to be competing with air travel between SFO and LAX, but then there are all these local stations. There's a lot of transit, TOD-type activities around these local stations that seems to be also trying to substitute away from car travel, even though current technology cars are more efficient than high-speed trains, energy-wise. So what's kind of the rationale balancing, between those two, other modes.
So the main market is definitely the long haul market, and we will capture short haul markets as we've seen through our modeling. So our model was is based on the MPOs throughout the state, and so SCAG's model and VTA's model, and you know, all the MPOs in between. We have collected a statewide model and put those together, and then we check that back with an international review committee that that's been able to review our analysis, and there's an enormous amount of literature on this on our website on the committee's work that was done for our high speed rail analysis. So we take the model work. We do three scenarios. We do a high, medium, and low projection for our ridership, and we use the high projection to do our environmental work. So how much traffic will be created and might need to be mitigated in each community, and elements mostly from cars about accessing the station come out of that model, and then we take the median medium ridership, and we do our financial forecasts based on medium. So we take the worst of both cases to do our analysis and give us our projections. So that's how we're that's how and where we get our numbers from. And we do have it is showing a good amount of intra-regional trips, but the market and the line haul capture is from that long 100 to 400 mile trip. In LA, you're still within LA almost in that 100 mile trip. But so Bakersfield to Anaheim is still within that long haul. It's not just it's not just LA to San Francisco. So being competitive with the car is still within that market. And I'm not sure the findings you have a car trip being more efficient than a train. What's the measure you're using for that?
I mean, just at current technology levels, like, you know, I guess it depends a lot on your energy mix, which obviously the state has, you know, high hopes of and targets to meet on, you know, more alternative energy in the state. But high-speed trains, at least internationally, running, you know, in Japan, China, and Europe, compared with comparable cars on short-haul routes, cars run at more energy-efficient level than trains. High-speed trains, not the conventional trains, but because of the high speed, they're less energy efficient than conventional rail.
So one thing I didn't put in my slide is we've got a policy. We're going to use 100% renewable energy, which might put us into a different measurement than the international systems you've been looking at, and who might be generating their power from not 100% renewable energy. That's as much as I can. That's as deep as I can go on that one. Yeah.
I really liked your early slides where you compared the different modes of long haul transport, but you know the duration and the proportion of the trip length that was usable for productive purposes. I've always think that's an interesting way of thinking about the high speed rails that is competing with Southwest Airlines, which goes to Sacramento or goes to, there's the time is apportioned differently. Are you going to be able to take any cargo on this train? Are we just talking passenger transport?
Right now, we're talking just passenger transport, and you know, if there's it's not being planned for freight.
Because I think that the world's been changing in the last 5 years with regard to package delivery. I mean, I'm thinking Amazon and FedEx, and there where time is of the essence, and they want to deliver things same day. And you know, my wife got something from Amazon on a Sunday. She ordered it, and it arrived Sunday night. So that's getting like same day, same Sunday.
Yeah. I had the same experience recently.
So that seems to be changing the calculation that somebody's making about the importance of time and delivery. So I mean, I suppose that they could still send stuff by Southwest, mm-hmm. or they can send one of their trucks up the interstate and get the 8 hours of travel time that way. Mm-hmm. But is there any way that you see that it might tap into a new funding stream from Amazon, say, on package delivery to the Bay Area?
It could. The infrastructure created for those Amazon and UPS and that is in place at the airports. You know, you've got a big distribution center at most airports and are able to reach the regions. Doesn't mean that it wouldn't grow around high-speed rail, but it's not something that we looked at it early on in some of our earlier business plans and earlier environmental work, and decided against that as a strategy. That doesn't mean a concessionaire might not come in and say, you know, that that's our value and we need to have that, but at this point that's not our current plan.
So do you know, does FedEx or anybody fly out of Burbank?
I don't know for sure, no.
I am impressed you have a station right by the airport.
Yes.
And that's the point where they come closer together. And so it strikes me there's something interesting could happen off of that station connection there. I'm not sure what.
Right.
But it creates a potential there.
How do you expect this project to affect housing and rent prices in the cities it's going to go through?
We don't have that analysis done. And so that's some of the work that's being done in the stationary planning at the cities. And we're also initiating some work in statewide also. But the intention is to plan so that we can accommodate it around the station. And we have now years and years of research on how TOD has affected that. And so some of the the mandates from the lessons learned from like Metro has now got a affordable housing target that they're trying to reach around in their transit oriented development program around their stations. We're learning, and so we don't have a projection yet on what it would do for rents, either for housing or even for a commercial property. How much additional value might be if there was an investor that might be able to want to invest in the area because high-speed rail is coming. It's something that hasn't, we don't have enough data on yet to have that, but we're collecting it now.
I should mention on the team we're just working on the Palmdale-Burbank segment, and I won't go through all the numbers. There are 26 firms, but one of the key firms is The Economists. And are looking at things like value capture, et cetera, but they're all in the exploratory stage at this particular point as well to understand those impacts and those relationships as well. And then each of the station teams themselves also have economists on their team as well. In some cases, I think it's the same economist, but we won't go with that comment as well. Question.
Hi, in the Northeast, the Northeast corridor, like Amtrak, that segment is probably the other commercially viable part of trail rent transportation in the country, and it's currently plagued by maintenance problems and funding issues to maintain the tracks. What kinds of lessons have you learned from that, or what sort of structures or funding mechanisms do you have in place to ensure that this system will be able to be maintained at the levels it needs to be in the future?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the Northeast Corridor is a higher speed system. It's not high speed rail by today's worldwide standards, although I think when the bullet train first opened in Japan, when they called it the bullet train, it was going about as fast as the Northeast Corridors, and that's the technology's advanced. And so our system is, we're planning for 220 miles an hour throughout our system. The maintenance required on the high-speed rail tracks to keep them up I don't want to give out the wrong answer, but it's more than twice, probably a lot more than what we have to pay to maintain a regular track. And that all goes into our operations and maintenance estimates. So our ridership revenue and projections all account for that cost. And most of our track is completely separate. So unlike in the Northeast Corridor, we'd have our own right of way to maintain, except in the peninsula between San Jose and in San Francisco, we're actually sharing the tracks with Caltrain, and we're making upgrades to their tracks to be high-speed rail ready. So that is definitely a lesson learned and something that we're planning for, and including our maintenance plan as well as our financial analysis.
The East Coast has got a lot more states involved. And you think that having just one state would improve our chances here? Do you think that would facilitate our maintenance and our long-term care of the line?
Right. There's not a series of MOUs or different operators or that. It'll be one operator, the whole line. Yeah.
The East Coast is a big problem.
Yeah.
I have a question about the vehicles themselves. You talk about kind of using like an off-the-shelf design to try to maybe make things a little bit easier delivery-wise. Do you know how like the Buy American requirements are going to impact, you know, finding a builder and getting them actual trains built?
I don't know the exact answer. I'm pretty sure Buy America still would be required from our builder. I'm thinking about the in light rail back in the 70s, we didn't have anybody manufacturing here, and then Siemens and others built plants as the system matured throughout the U.S. And so now, because of the Buy America, it's been, you know, we have had a strong influence on the industry and how it happened. But I don't know the answer on that.
But you have like prospective vendors who would be able to build them at least, right? Like, they wouldn't have to like necessarily build a new plant in order to build these trains, or.
I don't know enough. I do know that Siemens built an awesome mock-up of a high-speed rail train and plopped it on in front of the state capitol for a few weeks there, and we all got to like walk inside the cardboard mock-up. So they were making a statement.
Yes. Yeah. So some of the offset activities you talked about for the environmental and sustainability plans for the rails, when you're talking about like building, like say planting trees or creating a tree corridor, I know that takes a lot of water. And some of the areas in some of the cities that are there, they're in areas that are not necessarily drought resistant or may lack water. Is that something you've taken into consideration for like the environmental impact at all?
Yeah, that's a good question, because that is the trees are, you know, they have to be located, they have to be sustainable, and they all have to come with a plan on that. So we're actually working with one of the state agencies that actually knows a lot more about trees than us, Cal Fire, to help locate where the trees could be sustainable and live for a while. And I'm not sure about the water question, but that's a good one to think about.
But I just want, we all owe Tony Mendoza a big round of applause.